Good to have our second edition of the talk on Education for All by Vidya and Rajaram. Let me give a brief bio. They're both amazing people. I just read the bio. Very impressive. Professor Rajaram S. Sharma has a master's degree in science education, MSc.D in chemistry, a master's in education, and a PhD in education. In a career in education spanning over three decades, he has been a teacher, teacher educator, trainer, and researcher. He has explored active methods of learning, helping children become independent learners, enhancing teachers' competency and capacity for innovation, and helping school systems explore appropriate ICT to reach out and bridge divides. In his association with NCERT between 1996 and 2016, he led initiatives in exploring appropriate applications of ICT in education, including radio and television, audio and video, web and interactive multimedia applications. He was closely associated with the implementation of national policy of ICT in school education and the development of a national repository of open education resources and an ICT in education curriculum. He also, his other initiatives in education technology include the rollout of ePaathshala, a web and mobile interface, which provides access to digital versions of textbook, and the Swayam MOOC initiative, which provides access to online courses in school education. He retired as the joint director of Central Institute of Educational Technology, NCERT, in 2016. Guys, welcome Rajaram.
Yeah, thank you.
Impressive.
Dr. Vidya MS has a PhD in physics. By the way, I had no idea she had a PhD in physics. From the University of Mysore. She was a recipient of the Fast Track Postdoctoral Fellowship of the Department of Science and Technology, Government of India. In a long association spread equally between theoretical nuclear physics and education, she has been a teacher, researcher, science communicator, and technology enthusiast. She has research publications in international journals, monographs on introduction to vectors, axial vectors, tensors, and spinors. And technology tools for teachers, and a series of books on nature stories for young readers focusing on method of science. In fact, when I had gone to their place, she showed me many of her books that they've written for children. Amazing. And in fact, it's available. She has developed and managed a website, vidyaonline.net, which focuses on supporting teachers and parents. She has developed multimedia resources for children and lay public. She has also developed and offered training programs and online courses for teachers. So in fact, I just opened it today. So there's a lot of very interesting. You can't see my screen yet, right? Okay. Yeah. Let me just share you. Can you see the screen now?
Yeah.
Okay. This is Vidya's website. I was just browsing it today morning. So there's lots of stories for young readers with videos and so on. So it's pretty interesting stuff. She also has printed books that, in fact, she gave me a copy of when Sunita and I were visiting them earlier. So I just wanted to say, you know, like earlier I was telling Anya, we talk a lot, but there are people here with PhDs and understanding of physics and understanding good, you know, in-depth understanding of education that we need to, you know, hear more from. So welcome both Vidya and Rajaram for your talk here.
Thank you.
Very cool. Great introduction.
Okay, with that, over to you guys. I will put on your, can you guys see the slide here?
Yep.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay, over to you.
Thank you, Srikant, for the very long introduction. The more important thing is to worry about what education is and what all really means. And that's why the double question marks that we have in the very first part of our slide.
Mm-hmm.
I have sort of forgotten what it was like to be in school because it's been so many years, perhaps more than 50 odd years. And our engagement with schools, with education is more clearer when we consider our children and their pursuits and their educational careers. It is with this in mind that I believe that when we speak about education, each one of us think differently. We are not very clear about what we mean by education. And for each one of us, it has a different connotation. Hence, it is very essential for us to pin down what we mean by education, make a proposition of what we are trying to speak of in this presentation, and take it forward from here. I believe the process of education should enable every single individual with a chance and a means to grow into an autonomous thinker. Again, this requires a bit of an explanation. When we speak of every single child, we believe that they should be in a position to very quickly learn how to learn. And this learning would be essential for them to progress in their lives.
To a point where, for instance, they can look out for themselves, take charge of their lives in a way, be able to decide, make choices, move to places where they want to be, or you know, they are most comfortable with. In a way, build their personality, build their abilities to a point where they are on their own. And this, we believe, is a kind of a foundation for their ability to look out for the community. You know, education, we might have gone about giving it many newfangled definitions, but this is the age-old proposition of a community looking out for itself. A group of older people who look out for younger children, groom them to take charge, and then in a way conserve the values, conserve the cultural ethos of that community. And that's what education ought to have become. And so therefore, to us, the pinnacle of, or you know, the point at which someone would call themselves educated is when they can emerge as a thought leader, as a person who could guide the rest of the community to make better choices for themselves.
Essentially, what we are trying to aim at is, we have all been doing a lot of things all our lives. Like, most of us have not got into the domain of education. Some of us have. Most of us have got into other professions, and we are leading a professional life that is satisfying and fulfilling. At the same time, when we look at various issues that is plaguing the society, and including our own case too, when it comes to either health or other such issues, we seem to be a bit doubtful about what we are supposed to do. We have questions. We have plenty of thoughts that can confuse us many a times. The emphasis is on trying to see that as we grow older and older, the confusion that we experience diminishes. It is more or less easy for us to take on spot decisions, and these decisions have to be informed decisions. So the process through which we will go through in order to achieve such a state is what is important. And this is also something that is considered as lifelong education. We are educating ourselves continuously and all along trying to focus a lot on what we think, what are the confines which will present us the thinking opportunities, and to think accordingly, to be in a position to do the right thing for ourselves and our community.
You know, when Srikanth proposed this title, perhaps he had in his mind the schooling process rather than the education process. And we deliberately sort of, you know, tried to focus on unraveling this problem that we have built for ourselves. We tend to conflate schooling to education. We believe that schooling is synonymous with education, and that schooling has to deliver on the goal of education. So when you look at the general scenario of schools have a very restricted scope. They have a very restricted physical and social space in which we can operate upon the young children who are given into their charge. We look at this entire process of education as being influenced by adults who are a part of the immediate family, the parents, the home, the neighborhood, the larger community, which today has one very important cog in its wheel, which is the media. We are looking at schools, the schooling system, the curriculum, the syllabus, the progression of children through schooling, all of these structures that we have created called schooling. And then finally, that individual called a teacher who has perhaps a relatively more direct influence on the children's upbringing. Now, all these four factors, they have a very large role to play in influencing the growth and development of children, their personalities, their views, their opinions, their very being. And unfortunately, what has happened over a period of time is that our over-dependence on this concept called school has allowed parents to outsource that responsibility to the school. The community, in a way, is tending to only negatively influence this whole process and not intervening in a constructive way, which perhaps was possible in a much less divided society, much less populous society, perhaps in smaller communities. Maybe even today, the cultural mores are dictated by what happens in the community. So in a way, all of these other factors have disowned their responsibilities and pushed everything towards the teacher. We are now going to a situation where we start blaming the teacher for every ill that comes about in children's development. And
Rajaram, do you want questions at the end, or is it okay to
ask? Yeah, I would suggest that, because we will keep this to about 20-25 minutes and then we'll open it up.
Fair enough. Yeah. Okay.
Now, what has happened with the schooling as an interface is that thanks to the fact that it becomes a very complex process, its own, the administration of schooling, the fact that we have textbooks, the fact that we have exams, we have progression of children from one class to the other, we have very large groups of children being mass educated together, we have timetables, we have all kinds of other structures which have been invented. And somehow the administration of that entire interface takes far more precedence than a focus on an individual child, whether the child is learning, not learning, the child is, developing those abilities that education ought to have actually been influencing. And this is a distortion that we will have to perhaps live with in the short run. Now, the teacher left alone to do this whole business of education is our, thesis right now, in order to argue that therefore, it forms a very limiting interface through which our children are being educated. So on the one hand, what we are looking at is that we have tended to believe that schooling will take care of education of our children. And we have not focused on the other factors, the community, the parents, the rest of the society. And the negative influences of those, society has progressed, or if that's what we want to call it, it has changed. It has changed where individuals have sort of tended towards becoming more self-interested, focusing only on their own individual welfare, focusing on building up abilities for careers, building up abilities for, somehow being clever and make the most of the opportunities available. There isn't a total overall societal structure which is sort of, holding us together. And on this, we have imposed a factory model, a model which, looks at every child can be educated the same way. Every child given the same standardized curricula, the standardized resources is going to make progress the same way. And therefore, each of us is finally left with only one option, that is of gaming the system. So we go for tuitions, we could take entrance examinations, we somehow or the other manage to get into some courses or the other, end up with some degrees which will allow us to position ourselves somewhere in society. The socioeconomic possibilities of this are well established. In the sense, all our children have progressed well through the system, so we don't tend to question this. But if you look at the throughput of the system, the schooling system at large. More than 60-70% of the children never ever come even close to completing primary education. And then those of them who are left out, a very significant number of them will not pass the 10th grade. So essentially 50-60% of the population of any society is sort of doomed to be at the bottom rungs of the society. This might be a very convenient thing. After all, you require foot soldiers for everything that we want to do. But then education is not doing what it ought to have been doing for them. Even those people who pass out through this, the schooling bottleneck and somehow manage to get themselves a career, somehow manage to economically do well, they have not been able to progress on that, the kind of a hierarchy that I presented in the beginning, saying that they perhaps have learned to learn in a way. They know how to read, they know how to write, they know how to access information, they know how to process that and get a lot of tasks done. But that itself is intimidating, and therefore they limit themselves to certain small verticals. Like for instance, those of us who are not in the medical profession might not know enough about health, enough about our own health. And we might forever be dependent on another interface called the medicine. In a very similar manner, we could argue about various other sectors. And we have somehow limited our education to only a narrow part and become incapable of taking on the larger problem of looking out for oneself. Now, this therefore means that our ability to look out for the community, look out for other influences which are harming the community, look out for influences where large scale, large numbers of people are being affected by various things, that becomes very limiting. We are not doing that. And very few of us somehow are managing the inclination, the capability, and the initiative to emerge as a thought leader of trying to influence others about, how the society ought to be, how certain sections of the people are being deprived of education, how we are not looking out for our own, kin. And of course, the larger issues of climate, the larger issues of other flora and fauna around in the on the world, on Earth, and so on. So essentially, we are arguing that schooling is a very limiting kind of interface, and that schooling cannot be vested with that responsibility, the overall responsibility of bringing up our children. We need to do something about
it. Those three other quadrants also will have to contribute to the overall development of our population.
Can you repeat the three pillars, three things that you said?
The home, the community, the school
and okay. The teacher.
Those were the four quadrants. We have somehow pushed everything onto the teacher. Now, the influence in the larger community outside cannot be undone by the teacher. Similarly, if the parent is only sort of, using the school as an interface for, babysitting, the school cannot take on all that response.
Got it.
Finally, what do we believe that we can do to overcome this? Essentially, it is all the four quadrants will have to contribute to the development of every single child. We notice that we have a lot of inputs about children, about the way they develop, about the influences that they come across in their lives, in their growing years. These things have to be also factored in when we consider whatever happens in the school. All these are generally considered when they come up with something known as a curriculum document or a syllabus. The syllabus is more or less pertaining to only the subjects that are taught, but all of these are put under the garb of a curriculum where the entire process that has to be adopted is outlined. There seems to be very little information about such things, either with the school or with the homes. It is essential for them to understand that being just capable of getting marks in the examination is inadequate. There has to be many more other aspects to what goes under the name of education. A lot of education, educating the parents itself is necessary, and this is area which has received very little information, very little inputs, and parents themselves do not have adequate information about these. When we look at our own children, like Harsha himself has mentioned that all the successful ones are abroad. There's nothing wrong with being abroad, because ultimately we are all interested in our earth and the single earth. Wherever we can go ahead and serve Mother Earth, it is good enough. It has, it will have its impact. Whatever good happens there will be available to everybody around the globe. It is only the important thing is about each one of us becoming capable of leading everybody else, and more importantly, for the entire lot to become discerning people, so that they know for sure what is it that is happening right with us and what is it that is not right.
You know, in the long run, one if were to ask what changes ought to come about, I might want the moral compass of the community, the moral compass of the overall society to retrieve itself, to correct itself, and so on. But that's the long haul. And the hope lies in the fact that a large number of individuals become competent enough to question this, competent enough to guide the society in retrieving this moral compass. But in the immediate run, what teachers, schools, curricula, syllabi, textbook, resources, parents, media, all of us can together do is to shift this focus from teaching to learning. You know, this entire thing is somehow about an examination, a kind of a gate pass to careers and so on. If we can focus on the fact that there is not just the cognitive or information learning that happens in school, but there is also a socio-emotional connect with the society, with other people, with, you know, the world at large, which needs to be cultivated in children. And the best means for that is to make them independent, make them, you know, explorers of that knowledge and so on. So to towards that, we believe that what the teachers can immediately do is to privilege learning. And when we refer to this phrase learning for learning to learn, we are looking at all those abilities of children to be inspired, first of all, to explore things on their own. And the teacher can play a very big role in inspiring learning, facilitating this learning, guiding this, the means of learning. And then the most important part about learning is that learning is not the input. Learning is not the information that you receive from someone, but what you make out of that information. And that making out of that information is a kind of organizing of our cognitive maps and so on. So therefore, you need a constant challenge to that, to provoke you to solve problems, to provoke you to apply this knowledge somewhere else, to provoke you to rearrange it, to provoke you to question whatever information you get. And that becomes extremely important in the present circumstances where, you know, you don't know which information to trust. And therefore, a re-emphasis on learning in the schools can be a very good immediate fix to the issues that we are discussing. So I think we have sort of covered what we wanted to say, and we would be glad to sort of open this out for a discussion and face any questions.
Awesome, awesome, excellent. Hey, excellent presentation and thoughts on education. And you took it to a very sort of basic level of, you know, is the kind of education we're looking at, where we're dumping everything to teachers, is the right way of going about it. That's fantastic. So Raghu has his hand up. Raghu, go ahead with your question.
Did I have my hand up? Okay. I'll lower my hand.
I can see your hand up.
No, like no. This. I will ask a question. Thank you. I think I did that by mistake, but
okay.
This is fantastic information. Nobody thinks about education as, you know, beyond the four walls of the school. And this opens up a big, nice window for everybody to think a little bit out of the box. I keep telling people, or I often think, you know, school system is so limited, biased. They learn subjects, they learn curriculum, but when they go out, they don't know how to live their lives. You know, simple things like, how do I change the switch or bulb? How do I do my taxes? How do I change my tire? You know, living life successfully or being able to live life in a little quote unquote independently. There are things like book smart versus street smart. And then again, there's, you could be street smart, but you may not be able to do things like you said, you know, we don't have an idea of medicine. How are we going to even do first aid on ourselves? So there's a fundamental mistake in the whole term education in my mind. So how do we change this stuff? How soon should we get into the education system? How can we impact the education system to make changes? So people who come out of, say, 12th grade, they come out and they're able to kind of live their life a little bit on their own. If they should. A long-winded question, but...
Yeah. Incidentally, it will be, you know, interesting to know that throughout the takeoff time or...
That makes sense. Yeah, we can at least see each other. Yeah, nice. Okay, yeah, please.
Right. So if you look at the aims of education, and if you look at the reason why schooling as a structure emerged, or you know, schooling as a process, the entire curriculum being defined worldwide, we have been talking of the same things. We have constantly repackaged it, constantly adopted different subjects, different mechanisms, different methods for doing these things. But in general, schooling as a concept has not changed at all. The limitation comes about when the extraneous structures like exams, like, you know, you have to cover three languages, you have to cover six subjects, you have to do this progression up to this point, and then you will get this examination, and then you have to clear this examination. These are distortions in the system. And every time a new policy, a new curriculum has come about, people have tried to refocus on that. So one of those things that has happened is that, you see, if you take a child going for all the way from 2+ years when it first enters school, all the way till age 18 when it has to pass out of 12th grade, there is a long enough period for education to happen in the school. Generally, we sort of, you know, somehow believe that those also have to mimic the 12th grade examination, and therefore there is a pass out of LKG into UKG into first standard into second standard and so on. We impose subjects and we say, you know, getting some marks in some subjects are what is the evidence of children's growth and ability. So essentially, if we can step back a little and ask ourselves, what is it our child should have been capable of when it became 8, when it became 10, when it became 12, and so on, would be a good way to reprioritize our expectations from schooling as parents. And also, as teachers, we would be able to sort of step back and say, okay, we don't really have to cram in these things. We don't have to, you know, insist on these homeworks, these classworks, these tests, these structures that we have created for ourselves, but focus on liberating that child, inspiring that child, getting that child excited about something, get the child to do all of these things, and then, you know, celebrate education. In a way, the teachers are, neither are the teachers celebrating education, nor are children able to celebrate education. Somehow,
but there needs to be some guidelines there, right? So who is responsible to expand it into these other life skills. That's what I'm saying, because it's going to be impossible to add extra on the teachers and the parents and the curriculum. So something has to give.
No, I do agree, Raghu. The point is, things have got things have progressed in such a way that some bare minimum is being achieved. Once a bare minimum is achieved, the parents also believe that that is all that they have to expect. So it is a gradual process by which everybody, all the four quadrants that we spoke of, it is not that people do not know what to do. People know. But when it comes to the practical day-to-day affairs in a school, there are too many things that are happening in a school simultaneously. understand the learning and the teaching part of it, it is the administration of this teaching and learning that is taking a lot of time and effort. Consequently, the bare minimum is getting done.
Okay.
The process that everybody together will have to keep raising this and bringing in more and more doable things in the school. It is not, we have a lot of time. It is a question of organizing ourselves and putting the emphasis in the correct place.
I think
shall we move on to the next question? We have a couple more hands. And Anya was the brightest student in the class, getting first rank and all that. Her hand is up. So let's give her a chance to ask a question. Go ahead.
No, my question was very similar to... 1 minute. My question was very similar to Raghu's question. Like people are more, what can I say? Yes, the teachers are forced to finish the syllabus, whether the syllabus means anything or not. The parents are more interested that the children get marks. They don't really bother whether they are learning something or not, whether they can answer in the exams is the main thing. So somehow the focus of the whole education system, I think, should be changed from what... Someone is very persistently calling. Anyway, so I think the focus should be changed from this kind of exam-oriented, knowledge-oriented, not really knowledge, but mugging-oriented kind of education or teaching. That was my observation.
You see, the point that I was trying to make in response to Raghu's question and therefore your question also is that researchers have not disagreed on what ought to be the aims of education. Consequent conceptualization of a curriculum, if you get into the national policy or the national curriculum framework in the context of India, you will find these things mentioned. In fact, continuous comprehensive evaluation is what is being proposed in lieu of education. And this again is not a new idea. Since 1964, we have been singing this. What we have allowed is a distortion inside the system, which can, you know, and exactly the points that you were bemoaning is what you mentioned, that the parents have figured out the bare minimum thing that they need to achieve in order to comply with this notion of success. So a child will succeed if the child gets 99% marks. Becoming a good citizen to hell with, you know, doing all kinds of other growth and development and capabilities of children. This is exactly the distortion which must be addressed. And somehow stepping back, becoming more peaceful about this whole thing and asking the base questions, which have always been said. It's not as if, you know, Vidya and I are saying something new today. This perhaps is the bemoaning that every intellectual who will address this issue of education has been saying this. So much so, there is a large literature on de-schooling society. the society has been schooled to comply, schooled to, you know, accept things the way they are, schooled to believe in misinformation, in news as a channel of truth. They need not be so. So the crap detector that we need to build in children is what the focus ought to be on. And while I know that this is going to be for some of us who are sitting outside, we have almost zero influence on how to make this happen inside. But for teachers, there is a small chance, not so much, but nevertheless a small chance in not focusing so much on information, but focusing on children. This is that change that we are trying to propose. We are saying, focus on that child. Focus on that child becoming something better than what it was yesterday. Maybe through that year. Maybe through that 4 years of primary school, high school, secondary, whatever. And therefore, the child also starts recognizing that I need to be responsible for whatever it is that I am becoming. Finally, the child is being made into somebody. And it is that responsibility that the child has to wield. Yes, we don't have an easy answer to this thing. And if there was, perhaps people would have already acted upon it. But dismantling some of the existing bottlenecks, impediments to this whole thing might be a good starting point.
Okay, so we have two more questions. There is raised hands by Harsha and Hema, Hema Harsha as well. So let's go with Hema first. Hema also has a PhD. Hema, over to you.
Good morning, everyone. It's really nice to be a part of your discussion, and that's a fantastic thing you people are doing. This morning when Harsha told me that there is something related to education and it would interest me, I said, fantastic, I'll join. And I think this is beautiful. I think both of you gave a lovely presentation. Some education is something which is very, very close to my heart. And when you said celebrate education, I think that's a fantastic statement, I mean, phrase to make. It's really lovely. But being in the education field in the last, say, 18 plus years, I've taught school children also. I've taught MBA students as well. There is one thing which I've strongly seen, that is, there's a strong conditioning in our society. This conditioning which everybody spoke about now, Anya spoke about it, Raghu spoke about it. This conditioning that you have to get so much of marks to enter. Of course, we always tell the students, don't look at the marks. That marks is there only to enter into a particular college or say get a job. But eventually it turns out that all these four quadrants, what you spoke about, home, community, school, teacher, everybody stresses on, okay, you need to get that target marks to get in somewhere. So children also tend to focus on that. So this sort of a conditioning has been there from the beginning. So any thoughts about how can we undo this conditioning? Where do we start? Because every time when we tell it's okay, learning is very important, that comes at a later stage. When I talk to my MBA students, eventually they also talk about, ma'am, we need to get a campus placement. I need to get that 70% if I want a placement. So this sort of a conditioning has started right from the beginning, right from the school stage. So this is a conditioning which is there in our society. I totally agree. There's a great distortion that was really well said. And you people being in the area and working in the field of education, little insight about how can we undo this conditioning which is there? Mm-hmm. In any insight into that? Mm-hmm.
Yeah, see, the schooling as a model is something that we have come to accept. And perhaps still we can find a good alternate mechanism for doing this. And homeschooling experiments and things like that have been tried out, but nothing to the scale of schooling. So therefore, till we can find a viable alternative to schooling, perhaps we'll have to bear with it and not suffer what it gives us. Nevertheless, there are a large number of small experiments again, across the world and across centuries, where people have tried to dismantle the debilitating effects of these structures. You know, the children passing out from one grade to the other, all children with differing abilities being put together. On the playground, children don't worry about ages. And in fact, it's a slightly older child who will influence the younger child's habits and personality. And children do look to like children to guide them. But in schools, we will, you know, make an age-wise stratification and sort of dump them all together into classes and so on. So various aspects of these, you know, this larger picture has been addressed by enormous numbers of experiments of this kind. Maybe if people are interested later on, we could share some of this literature also with you. Essentially, what they have discovered is that children are being conditioned to believe what you said is an effect of conditioning. That 12th grade is very far away, 12 years away. And there's no reason why a preschool child or a primary school child cannot be free and explore and enjoy its life. So somewhere along the way, the child perhaps does not have so much of freedom to decide for itself, but schools where this has been dismantled, where schools of children have been left free, to explore on their own, curricula have not become the kind of, you know, the overriding highway on which all of us will ride, all of us will go in line kind of. They have done well, except that it has also turned out that some of those children have not done well in the examinations at the end of this whole process. You know, the classic example is that of the Krishnamurti Foundation schools run across the country, what is known as Valley School, what is known as D School in Chennai, and in Varanasi, we have a heritage school and so on. in all these places, children somehow are so engrossed with themselves, with becoming happy and so on, that at the end of it, they find being shortchanged. They are not able to face the stress of an examination and so on. So essentially, it is possible to decondition at a slightly different level by refocusing on what ought to happen in the classrooms, the very activities, the very way in which we will introduce children to learning. But examinations will have to go. Examinations, incidentally, by the way, if you take percentages of children who actually take these examinations, these high-stake examinations and clear careers and so on, they constitute something like some 5% of the whole population. Of course, there are a lot more aspirants to that, but then the people who clear those examinations and actually become successful as a span. And this is indeed an upper middle class obsession in a way. Because as I mentioned, even in the state of Karnataka, that little statistics that Srikant has looked at earlier, of the total number of children who come up to 10th grade, we have already done away with 50% of the population. 50% of the children never take the 10th standard examination. And of those who take, only 60% pass. And of those who pass, many of them will never get to PU or to college. And it is only a very small portion of them who will take the PCMB and therefore suffer the CET and the, you know, entrance to the medical examinations and entrance to the engineering examinations and so on. So frankly, this high-stake thing is again, a media creation. If you take a larger population, a large number of them are simply not going to be affected by any changes that come about. This of course, is a statistic to be noted, but does not mean that those children are not suffering. Those children who are taking these high-stake examinations are being completely groomed to become compliant with an existing societal structure, which they also perhaps somewhere along the way should learn to later on in adult life question it, see that their children don't suffer from it, see if there are alternate ways of doing it. Again, no magic wand here.
Okay.
Just to add, Hema, just a second.
Yeah, sure.
The primary classes seem to have understood this and they seem to be doing a lot better than higher classes. So I believe that this has to be a gradual way in which all sectors of education start thinking about these issues. And as Rajaram said, try to minimize the focus on examinations. Examinations can be separate, but the learning process should be delinked from the evaluation part of it.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Well, I'm sure Harsha is waiting in an adjacent room with Hema, so maybe we'll give him a chance to ask the question.
They're socially distanced themselves.
He's in my Mysore.
So, go ahead, Harsha.
We are not in the next room, Srikant. We are in the next town. I'm in Mysore.
Oh, you're in Mysore, Hema is in Bangalore.
Yes, yes.
Okay. All right.
But you know, just like one of the couple of observations and some food for thought. One is, you know, during our time, our generation, we had the luxury of, you know, the social structure in what Vidya and Rajaram referred was about, you know, family where we had a grandparents, a joint family, cousins coming, going. So the whole lot of life skills which we had the privilege of learning without investing extra time. As part of enjoyment of life, we did that, which is totally dismantled today. And the nuclear family has played havoc on the system. That's one part of the story, which I think needs to be factored into these discussions. The other one is now, Ajaram, this whole system of education leads or is a funnel for the employment market. So, you know, if there could be some restructuring of the employment system, since you are also, you, Srikant, you're all there in influential positions where government policies and other things can be influenced. Just again, food for thought to see if you can influence these decisions about, you know, employing people with other skill sets rather than just marks and other things becoming a criteria. Because earlier, if you look at it, we had this just for engineers or even paramedicals, we had this system of ITIs. then diploma holders and engineers. Right? An ITI guy was the one who take care of site preparations, do the drawing in civil engineering, for example, or in the electrical field, he was the one who would actually go climb up a pole, put wires, do the connections and all that. Then the next level of hierarchy was the diploma holders and then the engineers. Today, everything seems to be hazy, and like how you said, the high pressure group which comes to engineering and medicine compared to the people who do ITIs and diplomas, they're all becoming redundant.
Yeah, actually,
so I don't know if there's a food, it's just food for thought to see how, you know, you can build a bridge from these thoughts about refining the education system to see how it impacts the employment system. If you can do something like that, it'll add value. And just to give you a lead, you know, this Dr. Balasubramaniam here from Mysore, that Vivekananda Kendra, yeah, he's been nominated to the skill development forum in Delhi. So, you know, if you can use your local connections and get him to listen to you and build a bridge between, see, the NEP and all is okay, it's working in isolation, but it doesn't build a bridge to the employment, which is the final destination, right? So that bridging is something, I don't know, put on, what are your thoughts on that and how we can take it forward?
Yeah, let me also sort of add to that question. See, my thinking again was along the same lines as Arsha's. Eventually, if you leave the complexities that we are discussing, because we can get into analysis paralysis from a policy point of view, because it's a very complex problem and many countries have. In the US, it's the same discussion. Education is lousy. We don't have good deal. All that is going on, right? Same thing. So if we simply take the thing that what do parents want? They want their children to get a job, right? That is basic. I've gone to so many government schools here. My son and daughter, they were doing some projects and all that stuff. Every headmistress told us, you're rich, you live in these good places and all that stuff. Can you teach our kids English? Can you teach us math? Okay, this is exactly what they said. Every headmistress, okay? They didn't ask for anything complex. They said, send your kids here. You people come here, teach our kids math and English. That system has understood that English and math is giving you jobs, okay? So my own thinking was when I was, you know, in Mysore, enjoying Mysore during COVID, I went to a few, couple of schools and I was teaching computational thinking in Kannada. Okay, I was trying to see if Kannada students, we can impart some amount of computational thinking that they might become IT engineers, they might become part of the IT industry. And I was telling them, if you want to be a security guard, you'll make so much money. If you want to be a Swiggy delivery boy, you'll make so much money. By the way, these are the two most important jobs with the largest numbers. But if you become an IT engineer, this is how much these people are making. Okay, they're making lakhs. They're making some, 8 lakhs, 10 lakhs a year. These guys are making some 80,000 a year or whatever, right? Some crazy order of magnitude or two orders of magnitude difference. So my whole point was, there are jobs. There are an incredibly large number of jobs in those areas, which are very, very high paying. But these kids that you talk about, Rajaram, 60, 70% who drop out before 10th grade, they don't have a fighting chance of getting into those jobs. So the question was, but at the same time, I've seen incredible raw talent in kids, in people, in walks of life. We'll have a maid, we'll have a driver, and that guy's skills are like out of the charts, right? And you go, oh my God, if he only had gotten a decent education, this guy would have been a CEO or whatever. You know, he'd have been a top-notch executive somewhere building amazing products. It keeps coming back to me that somehow we have to unleash the potential of people to get jobs, because that's all parents want. Parents want their kids to get good jobs and have a better standard of living than themselves. So one thought was, to me at least, in the IT industry, the MOOCs, the content that's already there is sufficient to get you the best job in the world. Okay, there is enough content that teaches you Python or algorithmic thinking or computational thinking or everything. Okay, but the only thing is, these kids have no idea that that is important. They have no curated way of saying, okay, I'm going to learn this properly and get there. So my at least thought was, it's in a very limited sense, I was looking at it from an IT industry point of view, but other industries also, if curated content kids have access to because of free or very low cost geo bandwidth, and they have a phone and they start learning themselves, that's one way to get out of this rut that we're in. And hopefully, as the government sees that this is a viable model for our country to come up fast because the content is there, and slowly policy starts aligning itself to say, how do we open it up so that maybe, I don't know, this Indira Gandhi Open University and other kinds of things. Because frankly, you know, while physical education is so important and face-to-face is probably the number one, I don't see how we can solve the problem of having really good teachers everywhere, or even the community and the family understanding their role in all this and actually providing the right inputs. So my silver lining, I feel, is internet and content, okay, is available. But if somehow we make it available in a curated way for specific roles, and it could be like Harsha saying, for you know, what you call vocational training of specific things, you can become a mechanic, you can become a refrigerator fixer or whatever, and so on. So that was sort of my thought. I'll leave it at that and let you guys respond.
Yeah, in fact, all of you have sort of appreciated the problem that there exists knowledge, there exists information, there exists means to education, but the learner is somehow being inhibited from getting there. Now, that's exactly what we pointed out, that learning to learn is a capability which begins with the child learning to walk, the child learning to speak. The autonomy that we offer to this child, the responsibility that we pass on to this child, saying that you need to learn for yourself, you need to start walking for yourself, you need to start doing things for yourself, and so on. So de-teacherifying the school is what could be the way forward. In fact, if you now ask yourself, how did you benefit from schooling? You would perhaps attribute a lot more to the time when the teacher was not present in the school,
the freedom,
the friends with whom you mingled and did various things, the kinds of activities that you indulged in where you had the freedom of going and doing what you wanted, and perhaps a lot of such inputs, which is not subsumed under that formal, you know, the teacher talk, which occupied 40, 45 minutes at a time in every single period. And this has what has led to a fear being instilled in children. A child who is worried about examinations, a child who is worried about, you know, what questions are going to be asked, a child who is worried about, you know, the very survival through that schooling system, being compounded by parents who did not succeed, who are standing outside and prompting children to become clever, of go for tuitions, of, you know, learn these four questions, mug this up, or write this answer so many number of times, and so on. So this entire, the process that we are adopting in the name of learning is what has to be undone. How will differ from place to place. You rightly pointed out, today it is possible to leverage technology to handle many of these issues. And therein lies that issue. You see, through the pandemic, we did what is called online or virtual classrooms. Even now, that phenomenon is on. Till before this pandemic, we would restrict our children from the smartphone, saying that that's an evil device, you need to stay away from it. Whereas immediately after that, we allowed children to handle the device, but children could still not use it to go ahead and access whatever they wanted out there. So it is what you will get them to do using these devices, these means, that is more important. Again, when you refer to curation, you somehow believe children are not competent to find out their own ways of, you know, figuring out what to learn, what not to learn. At a very young age, yes, they need guidance. They need facilitation. They need to be handheld through a process of learning. But till what age, or at what age will you start saying, now it is your business to go and become an adult, become a self-learner, go ahead and find out things for yourself. Somehow we have delayed childhood. We have continued to believe that children are incapable of handling their own lives till they come to grade 12 or, you know, beyond that. That's and true. Suddenly they become a rebel after that, and then, you know, they stop listening in any case. So essentially this were factored in into the methods, and this is not again something new that I am saying. This has always been said, that children can learn to become independent learners, and they can start exploring that world. And technology will certainly provide a much, much, diverse variety of things. Maybe there are lots of things that children wouldn't have heard of amongst the things that I am hooked on to on YouTube nowadays are magic shows and a whole lot of things that, you know, we find people engaging with. And so therefore, it is possible to conceive of alternate learning spaces. School is not the only learning space. There are alternate learning spaces out there, perhaps much more potent, much more capable of inspiring children and facilitating their learning. So it's just a matter of dismantling some of these structures, removing some of these walls, and allowing that freedom, the time, the space for that. Yeah. And examinations, again, is a bogey which is compounded by the fears that we instill in children that they can't write for themselves, they can't read for themselves, they can't address, you know, read a question and answer the answers on their own. And this is that distortion that we were trying to highlight.
Okay, great. Any other questions, guys? Raghu, you had some question?
Yeah, I was going to say this all, again, it's going to be a part of evolution in the process of education, right? So, for example, the information that Harsha sent out, 50% of people are in US, or top 10 people are in the US doing something different. You come here and you see similar things are happening, but there is some deviation. There is something different happening in places. Like, for example, you go to MIT or Harvard or Yale, some of the Ivy Leagues, they're not only looking for GRE scores, they're looking for additional skill sets, they're looking at life experiences, they're looking at emotional construct, they're looking at what the kid has been exposed to. They give more importance to the essay they write in the admission process, right? So I think it is happening in one side of things. It's not totally lost. It's not that hopes are all lost. It's happening, but it has to happen in a bigger scale at an earlier stage in school. That's what I believe will help.
Okay. Any other questions? Bhagya, did you have a question?
No. I'm just listening to all of you.
Okay.
It's like, how do I make my grandson successful?
I saw him listening too. He's an early learner. Okay. All right. Well, guys, it's about 10:05. Do we have any other questions? Any comments? Anybody else?
Yeah, Srikant, I had one.
Yeah, please go ahead, Asha.
You know, in this regard, right now in the US, I think as a prelude to some higher levels of education in collaboration with PMI, they're doing a US-wide city infrastructure development competition for school children. Yeah. And I happen to be one of the judges on that panel for judging that. So it's a huge exercise which they're doing across the city for school children, where they have to actually make models where I explain how it works. So each team gets about half an hour to present their case to the jury panels. So it's a huge exercise that they're doing. So, you know, again, just food for thought. Nothing else.
Hey, Harsha, so my daughter, second daughter, she did something like that. It was a competition. It was a worldwide competition, which was built on, like you said, building something or solving problems, you know, problem solving skills, writing up their own skit, doing community work, putting all that together and presenting it on the stage, right? So it's amazing. That thing is happening around here a lot. It's called Destination Imagination. And Divya and her team, they actually won the international competition, beating 160 teams, and they came first in it. It was amazing. So there are opportunities, like you said, identifying it and exposing it to our kids is important. That is the process where we also have to learn to learn and see what's important for the kids and giving them the opportunity to do that.
Awesome. Okay, guys. So let's, you know, firstly, you know, awesome talk by Vidya and Rajaram on Education for All. Got us all thinking. We certainly, there are lots of questions. I'm sure we're going to go back and think some more about all this stuff. But I was going to say, Rajaram, especially because you worked at the center and you have, you know, sort of a knowledge of how policy is made in education space and how it can actually get implemented. I'd love for you to think about if somehow ordinary people like us, you know, I might do something in, I don't know, computational thinking, somebody else might do, you know, Harsha's daughter might do in law and so on. If we can create little courses and more importantly, make it available from like the government of India so that widely people have vocational areas where they themselves are empowering themselves, you know, and getting jobs. I think that would be awesome. Because I can understand putting a course together, because I did so myself. What it takes and what happens when you teach, what questions come up, do they even make sense of this? Is it too advanced for them, for a primary school or a high school? All of those I can figure out. And many of us can figure out, you know, Anya can do something on medicine and I'm sure she can figure out whether it's the right level of course, what is the content, what is the media, what is the video schedule? Well, all those are available today. But what none of us understand is how can you scale this as a policy of the government of India? Is there a place where this can actually go and where millions can access this and slowly, you know, of course they get accredited, maybe the course is approved and it's like a good course and so on. If they, that whole piece is a mystery. None of us sort of understand how this can scale. So that was a thought I had, if you can sort of address and think of how to take this further.
Yeah, a quick response to that. Incidentally, if you take the rollout of the new education policy, one of the forms which has been co-opted into it, this existed before the policy, but it has been co-opted into it, is what is called the Deeksha platform. This Deeksha platform is a part of your team of people who are associated with Aadhaar, Jagdish Babu, all those people. Yeah. Huh? So they accept.
Next step, yeah.
So the this platform is now the sort of de facto government approved platform on which every organization can pitch in and do what they believe is IT enabled education. So it's a kind of an omnibus platform of that kind. But nevertheless, there are lots and lots of people who are developing such courses. As you said, it's a matter of curation. It's a matter of someone who's at the teacher, in the role of a teacher. It could be a parent, it could be, you know, a community leader, it could be an NGO, it could be whoever, who sort of points it out to a group of people that, look, this thing exists. Like, if any of us care to curate, there is enough and plenty of not only research, but good books of, a good information available there, which can be curated. So this curation is what is one of those bottlenecks. The second is this learning to learn. So while we will leave it to the people who are in direct touch with children to see how they can cultivate learning to learn habits, but the curation is something that all of us can straight away pitch in. Even if you were to simply create a YouTube playlist, which brings together some of the YouTube videos, or you create a little website with links, which brings together certain things. These are eminently possible. And one of the directions in which Vidya Online was or is moving is towards these kinds of little courses. Of course, we had restricted ourselves to parents and teachers at the primary school level, because that is something that we believed we understood much more. But the kind of things that you're referring to in higher education or at the plus two level, where children have to make choices of careers, choices of courses and so on, it could be a good input. We can really do is at some point talk it over as to how the efforts that exist today can be expanded to cover many of our aspirations in this direction. Hey,
one point on that, I totally agree. That's a good point. But there are some resources, like, for example, Khan Academy, right? I think people know Khan Academy there. And Coursera, edX, all of these are all free education, like you said, all compiled and curated courses, and it's structured, very well structured, just like Vidya Online, but for a higher level of education, right? But my thing is, that might exist, people might learn it, but is it going to be acceptable in the job market? Are they going to look at it and say, you studied all of this, that's fine, now you're eligible. Instead of saying, do you have an MBA? Do you have an engineering degree? So again, it comes back full circle to the system, where it can be acceptable or not.
Two small inputs at this point. One is that there are a large number of US universities which are allowing private entities to offer credits. Courses which are taken completely in some other domain, some other sphere, but there is a credit transfer available. And the new education policy in India is again asking for it, moving towards that kind of a conceptualization, though they're you know, all of your Kannada fellows. Madivantike around, you know, whether an organization should offer the credit or whether, you know, a private entity can offer that kind of a credit is something that we'll unravel. But there is one other distortion here when you refer to the Khan Academy as an example. You know, a large number of such initiatives have always been spearheaded by the Intels of the world, the Microsofts of the world, the Googles of the world. And somehow or the other, their vested interests start influencing what can happen or what cannot happen. For instance, a large number of children from India have been taken abroad to participate in the competitions that you mentioned as a part of the Intel for Education interface. And somehow it sort of, you know, stays within the quote unquote Intel sphere. It doesn't get beyond that point. So therefore, reaches out to only particular segments of children, particular state governments which are willing to let them in, particular CBSE schools which are willing to let them in, and so on. So it doesn't become a universal phenomena. Khan Academy again has become a curated interface. They go and work with some states and say, we will translate all that material. And, you know,
very free, available online, right?
Oh, yes. But then you see, for instance, a child who can read only Kannada cannot access that material.
So there are surrounding language itself.
I see. Yeah.
That should be postponed because that is too much for a 1 hour discussion.
Well, with that, let's try and close. Again, hey, thanks a lot, Vidya and Rajaram. I mean, this is awesome. You guys are fundamentally asking us to rethink education. And I think it's, but not only do you have a deep understanding, but also you understand the wheels of government and how they work, policy and so on. So super useful for us to get a sense of this. Round of applause for our speakers today. Awesome job, guys. Thank you so much.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Awesome. Very good.
And I was going to say, let's have in our, we need more speakers. We have experts, but they don't say very much in our WhatsApp group. So we need more of this kind of session. Anya, you should do one on medicine, maybe pediatrics. Tell us a little bit about that. Or so we can also talk about strokes and so on. So why don't you guys doctors decide how you're going to go about it? Chandu can talk about various things. I mean, he's dying to share on the WhatsApp.
He'll have plenty to tell
us. Oh, we have to get him to organize his thoughts and put it together in a 30-minute.
Yeah, we can leave Chandu to be the WhatsApp guru and educate us through WhatsApp.
True. And of course, Jalil, who's you know, walking encyclopedia, can talk about, you know, philosophy and so on. So let's get this going. Well, we'll give a gap, as Anya says, maybe 2-3 weeks before we have the next one. But thanks, Vidya and Rajaram, for an excellent talk and presentation. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Perfect. Great, thank guys.
You. Thank you.
Have a good day. Bye, everyone. Thank you. Thank you, Vidya and Rajaram.
Bye. Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Have a good day.
See ya.
Bye.
See ya.